I once had a whim and I had to obey it, to buy a French horn in a second-hand shop. I polished it up and I started to play it, in spite of the neighbors who begged me to stop. To sound my horn, I had to develop my embouchure. I found my horn was a bit of a devil to play, so artfully wound, to give you a sound, a beautiful sound, so rich and round. Oh, the hours I had to spend before I mastered it in the end. But that was yesterday, and just today I looked in the usual place. There was the case, but the horn itself was missing. Oh, where can it have gone? Haven't you? Hasn't anyone seen my horn? Oh, where can it have gone? What a blow! Now I know I'm unable to play my Allegro. Who swiped that horn? I bet you a quid somebody did, knowing I found a concerto and wanted to play it, afraid of my talent at playing the horn. For early today, to my utter dismay, it had vanished away like the dew in the morn. Tooting. I've lost that horn. I know I was using it yesterday. I've lost that horn. Lost that horn. Found that horn. Gone. The stock of a choke. I willingly pay a reward. I know some hearty folk whose party jokes pretended to hunt with a quorn. Gone away, gone away. Was it one of them took it away? Will you kindly return that horn? Oh, where is the devil who pinched my horn? I shall tell the police I want that French horn back. I miss its music more and more and more. Without that horn, I'm feeling sad and so forlorn. I found a concerto and wanted to play it this way, my talent of playing the horn, but early today, to my utter dismay, it had totally vanished away. I wanted to play it, but somebody took it away. I practiced the horn and was longing to play it, but somebody took it away. My neighbor's asleep in his bed. I'll soon make him wish he were dead. I'll take up the tuba instead. Wah, wah.
Thank you very much. I should warn you, he wrote two more in E-flat alone. Next time we'll take the festival hall. One of the great problems of the world today is undoubtedly this problem of not being able to talk to scientists because we don't understand science. They can't talk to us because they don't understand anything else, poor dears. This problem, I think it was C.P. Snow first raised it, Sir Charles Snow in private life, in his books Science and Government and so on. Mind you, I haven't read it. I'm waiting for the play to come. He says, quite rightly, he said, it's no good going up to a scientist and saying to him, as you would to anybody else, you know, good morning, how are you, lend me a quid, and so on. I mean, you just glare at you, or make a rude retort, or something. No, you have to speak to him in language that he'll understand. I mean, you go up to him, you say something like, H2SO4, Professor. Don't synthesize anything I wouldn't synthesize. And the reciprocal of pi to your good wife. Now, this he will understand. Snow says that nobody can consider themselves educated who doesn't know at least the basic language of science. I mean, things like Sir Edward Boyle's law, for example. The greater the external pressure, the greater the volume of hot air. The simple... Or the second law of thermodynamics. This is very important. I was somewhat shocked the other day to discover that my partner not only doesn't know the second law, he doesn't even know the first law of thermodynamics. Going back to first principles, very briefly, thermodynamics, of course, is derived from two Greek words, thermos, meaning hot, if you don't drop it, and dynamics, meaning dynamic work. And thermodynamics is simply the science of heat and work and the relationships between the two. As laid down in the laws of thermodynamics, which may be expressed in the following simple terms. After me, Donald.